So today's lecture will be on set theory. We will learn basically intuitively that sets are collections of elements where you have no duplicates, the order doesn't matter, and we'll learn the basic operations with sets. We'll learn membership into a set, subset operations, then we'll learn intersection, union, the power set, Cartesian product, cardinality of a set, and so on. So let's start from the beginning. The lecture is self-contained. It basically has all of the material contained. You don't have to know some pre-concepts to this lecture. So the set theory is the branch of mathematical logic that studies sets, which informally are collections of objects. And abstract set theory is one of the fundamentals of mathematical thought. Most mathematical objects, like numbers, can be defined in terms of sets. And we'll get into some of these issues, like Cantor's sets, but we'll basically define the basic properties of sets and the basic methods of proof for sets. So we will see how to prove using the element method for proving that the set is empty, the element argument method to prove is similar to the method of direct proof to prove that in a universal statement is true, which basically is that a set is a subset of another set. But we'll get incrementally to that. So we said that informally you can think of a set as a collection of objects, and it can be denoted by a letter, a capital letter. In this case, I'm using S, but you can use A, B, C, D, and so on. Now, we say that an A is a member of S, and we use this symbol, which is basically looks like an epsilon, inverted epsilon. It's stating that A is a member of the set S, meaning that A is an element of the set S. And here are some examples. 1 is a member of 1, 2, 3. 3 is a member of 1, 2, 3. So you see that it doesn't matter that is the first or is the last. A is not an element of S, is denoted by the same symbol but cut, meaning that A is not a member of the set S. And here we have an example. 4 is not a member of the collection of elements 1, 2, 3. If S is a set, like a predefined set, like the set of integers or a set of real numbers, and P of X is a property, then the elements of set may or may not satisfy the property P. And now we have a set construction notation that A is a set that contains all of the elements in S such that P of X is true. So it's basically the set of all the elements X of the set S such that P of X is true. So this is the constructive mode to construct a set out of another set, taking only the elements that are true based on some filtering property. It's also called a filter because you basically select all of the elements with some property P of X. Subsets. First definitions. A is a subset of B, and we use this notation. If and only if. For all x, if x belongs to A, then x belongs to B. So it's a formal universal conditional statement. We basically have for all x, if x is a member of A implies x is a member of B. The negation of that is A is not a subset of B, if and only if for all there exists an x such that x is a member of A and x is not a member of B. So you see that is actually the negation of the subset relation above. It basically, the negation transforms the universal statement into an existential statement and the implication into a conjunction of the antecedent and the consequent. A is a proper subset of B, and we have the same notation, but we don't have this equality. So A is properly a subset of B. If A is a subset of B, and there exists at least one element in B that is not an A. It is not in A. So B is bigger than A. It's not about the same size. So here we have an example. one is a subset of the set that contains one is a subset of the set that contains one. So we can actually see that we have a subset and we have proper subset. The set that contains one is a proper subset of the set that contains one and two, because the second set contains at least one more element than the ones that are in the first set. Also, we can see that the set that contains one and two is not a subset of the set that contains one and three. The set that contains one is a proper subset of the set that contains one and the set that contains one. So the elements of a set can be sets themselves. We can see it here. Now, if you want to prove the subset relation for some arbitrary constructed sets, you can do it through a method of direct proof, which is called the element argument method. It's the basic method for proving that one set is a subset of another set. If X and Y are two given sets with true properties or through constructive methods, to prove that X is a subset of Y, suppose that lowercase x is a particular but arbitrary chosen element of the set X. Then show that lowercase x is also an element of Y. So it's the method of direct proof. Choose a particular element but arbitrary chosen. It's not set to be a value. It's set to be a generic element in that set. So it satisfies the properties of that set. Based on the properties of that set, prove also that the properties for the same element X of the set Y are also satisfied. This shows that no matter what X you choose, arbitrarily chosen from the set uppercase X, is also an element of the set Y. So let me give you an example. So consider the following two sets, A and B. A is the set of all M belonging to integers, such that M can be written as 6R plus 12 for some integer R. B is the set of all integers N, such that N can be written as 3 multiplied with S for some S in integers. Our question is A a subset of B? So the element argument proof says that suppose choose an arbitrary but arbitrary chosen element of the set A. So let's say that X is that element. The method of the element argument method says that now you must show that X is also an element of B. So we have to bring that element from the form that M is 6R plus 12 into 3 multiplied with a 2S for some integer S. Now, so X was a particular but arbitrary chosen element of the set A. It must have the form of elements in the set A. So by definition of A, there must be some integer R such that X is equal with 6R plus 12. But we can give 3 as a common factor in both operands of that addition. So X is equal with 3 multiplied with 2R plus 4. 2R plus 4 is an integer S. Therefore, by definition of B, it must be that X is also an element of B. So every element of A, arbitrarily chosen, is also an element of B. Therefore, A is a subset of B. This is the element argument proof. In order to prove an implication, you choose an arbitrary element in the first set, and you prove that is an element also in the second set. Any questions? At any moment, if you have a question, you can just unmute yourself and ask the question, or write it in the chat. And from time to time, I will come to check if the chat is working, if basically you can hear me. Yes, so there is an issue with the website for the lecture notes. I was told that basically it's going to be fixed by the end of the week. The certificate is obsolete, so now it's basically deprecated. So they will generate a new certificate, and then you will basically not see that warning. But you can click advanced and go to the website. So I will show you here if you basically try to go to that website, because it's an HTTPS website, you basically have to click on advanced and then click on that, and you basically have access to the lecture notes. It's the entire CS department, so basically it will be fixed. Okay, good. So let's continue. Good. Now, disproving a property. So we want to show that for the same two sets A and B, B is not a subset of A. So we have to find a particular element of B, a counterexample, such that, B is not an element of A. So disproving that B is a subset of A means that we want to show that the set B is not a subset of A. That the set B is a subset of A is false. We must find an element of B with the form of the generic elements of B, x is equal with 3s, that is not an element of A, that x is not equal with 6r plus 12. So let's try to enumerate elements in A. So we have 0, but in B. We have 0, but then 0 can be rewritten as 6r plus 12. Then we have, for s equal 1, we have 3. So what about 3? 3 is an element in B because it's 3 multiplied with 1. Is 3 an element of A? We assume by contradiction that, yes, there exists an element, an integer r, the definition of A, such that 6r plus 12 is equal with 3, or 3 is equal with 6r plus 12. Now, you can divide both sides with 3. You get 2r plus 4 is equal with 1. You can subtract 4 from both sides. You basically get 2r is equal with minus 3. You can divide by 2, and you get r is equal to minus 3 divided by 2, which is minus 1 integer part 0.5, which is not an integer. So this contradicts our original assumption that we assume to exist an r, an integer. Therefore, by contradiction, it means that there exists at least one element in B that is not an element in A. So B is not a subset of A. So when you want to prove that for subset, you choose an arbitrary element and you show it in the second set. When you want to disprove, you basically have to prove the existential statement that there exists an element in the subset that is not in the superset. Therefore, it's not a subset. Set equality. So we define that two sets are equal, A and B are equal, if every element of A is also in B, and every element of B is also in A. That basically means that the two sets are equal if all the elements are in common. But we just basically use the property subset, because A is equal with B means that A is a subset of B, and B is a subset of A. So if we want to prove equality of two sets, we'll basically have to prove the two directions. We have to prove that for every element in A is also in B, and for every element in B is also in A. So let's see how to prove it for a concrete example. So consider that A is the set of all integers m, such that m is equal with 2a for some integer a, and B is the set of all integers n, such that n is equal with 2b minus 2 for some integer b. The question is A equal with B? The first part of the proof is to prove that A is a subset of B. So suppose by element argument proof that X is a particular but arbitrary chosen element of A. By definition of A, there must be some integer lowercase a such that X is equal with 2a. But you can add 2 and subtract 2, and the formula is still the same. So x is equal with 2a plus 2 minus 2. Now you can give 2 as a common factor in the first part of the first two operands. So you get x is equal with 2a plus 1 minus 2. You can choose b to be equal with a plus 1, in which case x is equal with 2b minus 2 for some integer b, because integers are closed under addition, and a was an integer, 1 is an integer. Therefore, x has the form of every element in b. So therefore, x is a member of b. So every element of a is also an element of b. Therefore, a is a subset of b. Second part of the proof. B is a subset of a, too. Suppose x to be a particular but arbitrarily chosen element of b. By definition of b, there must be an integer b such that x is equal with 2b minus 2. But now we can give 2 as a common factor. Let me change this little typo here. So you can choose to, give 2 as a common factor, and we get that x is equal with 2 multiplied with b minus 1. You can choose a to be equal with b minus 1, in which case x is equal with 2a for some integer a, which is the common standard form for the elements of a. Therefore, x is an element of a, which basically means that b is a subset of a. And now we prove both sides, that a is a subset of b and b is a subset of a. Therefore, a is equal with b. Now, in some cases, you can also use Venn diagrams to prove these kind of subsets. And what are Venn diagrams? Venn diagrams are disks, or basically areas in a plane, that symbolize the elements of that that are members of that plane. So of that set. So for instance, in our example here, A is a subset of B can be written in the two different forms, which are that A is a proper subset of B. A is a circle inside the circle that that is B, or that A is equal with B. So the Venn diagram for A is a subset of B is basically these two, or one of these two. A is not a subset of B can be written in different ways. It can be written as A and B have no common elements. They are completely disjoint. Or A and B have some elements in common, but there are elements in A that are not in B. And finally, that B is actually a subset of A. So there are elements in A that are not in the inner circle B. Now, you can combine them. So if you have multiple such formulas, you can actually combine them into common graphs. But you have to consider all possibilities for every formula. So for instance, if you have, let's say, two of such graphs, you have to combine the diagram that you, every single diagram that you've wrote for the first formula to every single diagram that you've wrote for the second formula. So, and if you cannot combine them, if you have a case, like for instance, if I try to combine this one with this one, I cannot combine them because one of them shows that set B contains the set A and the other one shows that A and B are totally disjoint sets, then I basically have a contradiction. I cannot create a Venn diagram for that formula. Therefore, that formula cannot be correct. And let me give you some examples of Venn diagrams for standard sets of numbers. And the standard sets of numbers are the integers, rational numbers, and real numbers. And what we know is that every integer can be written as a rational number if you take that integer and divide it by 1. So the set Z of integers is a subset of the set of rational numbers. However, we know that there are rational numbers like 1 divided by 2 that is not an integer. So in essence, in fact, integers are a proper subset of Q. Like 1 over 2 is not an integer, so there are numbers in Q that are not in Z. So we can see that if we draw the Venn diagram, Z will be a proper subcircle into the set Q, which is the set of rational numbers. Similarly, if Q is a subset of real numbers, because every rational number is also a real number. However, Q is a proper subset of real numbers because there are real numbers that are not rational, like for instance, square root of 2. Also, we saw in the exam, square root of 7. So again,
the Venn diagram for Q is a proper subset of the Venn diagram of R. Now, before we go to another set of standard notations for reals, let's learn the basic operations on sets. If A and B are subsets of some universal set U, and the universal set could be reals or could be any universal set that you will define, the union of A and B, notated with this kind of like a U, upper U symbol, A union B, is the set of all the elements that are in at least one of A and B. So if I use the set construction notation, A union B is the set of all the elements in the universe, U, such that X is an element of A or X is an element of B. So basically, A union B is the, if you consider Venn diagrams, is the grayed out or the blue out method a part of this Venn diagram. If this is the universe, the elements that are in the dark blue part are the elements that are either in A or in B or in both. The intersection of A and B is the set of all the elements that are common to both A and B. So A intersection B, and we use this symbol for intersection, is the set of all the elements in the universe X, such that X is an element of A and X is an element of B. So in Venn diagram notation, it would be those elements that are in common to A and B. So if A may contain other elements that are not in B, B may contain other elements that are not in A, but those will not be in the intersection. The intersection will be just the common part. If the two sets are totally disjoint, then you see that there are no elements in the intersection. And we'll learn that next when we learn about the empty set, the set that contains no elements. The difference of a set B minus a set A is also called the relative complement of A in B. B minus A, the standard notation, is the set of all the elements that are in B, but not in A. So all that are in B, but they don't belong to A at all. So B minus A is written as the standard notation for construction of sets, as all the elements in the universe X, such that X belongs to B and X does not belong to A. The complement of a set A, A complement, is the set of all elements in the universe that are not in the set A. So A superscript C is the A complement, and we read it as A complement, is the set of all the elements X in the universe such that X are not elements of the set A. So for instance, in the Venn diagram, if you have a set A and the universe, then all the elements that are not in the set A are basically the complement of A. So let's choose an example. Consider that we have a universe that contains the constants A, B, C, D, E, F, G. And A is the set of elements A, C, E, and G. B is the set of elements D, E, F, and G. A union B. And now basically we have the elements that are in common, no duplicates. Basically, we have a collection of elements, unique elements. So we see, if we take the elements in the universe in order, A is there, so we keep it in the union. B is not there, so it's neither in A nor in B, so it basically we don't put it in the union. C is in A. D is in B. E is actually both in A and in B, so we just keep one copy in the union. It's a set. F is in B, G is in both A and B, so basically we keep it. So the union will be A, C, D, E, F, G. And it made it easy that we had the sets in the same order that they appear in the universe. But remember again that order doesn't matter. So you can have them mixed on any possible order, but it makes it easier to sort them first, and then you can see easily what is the result of the union. Similarly, the intersection, what are the elements that are in common? A is not in B, C is not in B, E is both in A and B, so we keep it in the intersection. F is not in B, and G is in both A and B, so we keep it in the intersection. B minus A, all the elements that are in B but not in A, those are D and F. So basically those are kept. A complement, all the elements in the universe that are not in A, those are B, are D, and R is F. So basically A complement is the set that contains the elements B, D, and F. Sometimes you are given infinite universes in which if you do want to write the complement, you have to write it with formulas like the constructive notation for the set. Now, given real numbers, we can write as intervals the subsets of real numbers. So if A and B are real numbers and A is less than equal with B, then we can write the interval from A to B, not including A and not including B, and that's the way that you read such intervals, is the set of all the real numbers X such that X is strictly greater than A and X is strictly less than B. Similarly, the interval from A to B of real numbers, not including A but including B, so we use square bracket for inclusion of the range, and open and curly bracket for not inclusion in the interval, is the all the elements in reals such that X is strictly greater than A but less than equal with B. The set, the interval from A to B including A but not including B, is the set of all real numbers X such that X is greater than or equal with A and strictly less than B. And the interval from A to B including both A and B is the set of all real numbers such X such that X is greater than or equal with B and less than or equal with greater than or equal with A and less than or equal with B. Also, for real numbers, since in cases that we don't have the range, it's unbounded either for negative infinity or for positive infinity, we can use them as the limit of that interval. So the set of all real numbers from A to infinity, not including A, is the set of all real numbers X such that X is strictly greater than A. Similarly, the set, the interval from A to infinity including A, is the set of all real numbers X such that A is less than or equal with X. Similarly, for negative infinity, the set of all real numbers, the interval of all real numbers less than B, is the set of all the real numbers such that X is less than B. And finally, the interval from minus infinity to B, including B, is the set of all the real numbers X such that X is less than or equal with B. And now you can actually see on the real axis, if you draw the real axis, what are the elements that are basically in those intervals. And we will do an example during the recitation in which we intersect and union intervals of real numbers. Here we have a bunch of examples. So on the real axis, we represent the set A, which represents the interval between minus 1 and 0, not including minus 1 and including 0. It's easy to draw it because for the range that is not included, you can put a circle. And for the range that is included, you can either omit a circle or make a field disk at that location. So this basically represents all the reals X such that X is strictly greater than minus 1. So the interval does not contain the lower bound minus 1, but is less than equal with 0. So the interval contains 0 as the upper bound. Similarly, on the same real axis, I'm representing the set from 0 to the interval from 0 to 1, including 0 and not including 1. So you can basically see that X is greater than or equal with 0, but strictly less than 1. union and intersection of sets. So consider what is the union of the two sets. Is the set of all the real numbers where x belongs to minus 1 to 0 or from 0 to 1. So that will be basically the set of all real numbers greater than minus 1 and less than 1, which is basically the interval from minus 1 to 1, including all the real numbers within. The intersection of the two sets, what elements are in common in these two sets, is just 0, because we can see that the first set contained all the elements less than 0, the second set contained all the elements greater than 0, so the only element that is in common is actually 0 itself, and you can represent it as the finite set that contains the element 0. You don't need to represent it as an interval, because it basically as an interval would be square bracket 0 comma 0 square bracket, close square bracket. So really it's a single element, you don't need to represent it as an interval. You can, but there's no need. The difference between two sets, B minus A, specifically, is all the elements that are in B but not in A. The only element that is in B but is in A is 0. So basically the difference between the two, B minus A as intervals, is the set from 0 to 1, not including 0 and not including 1. Now, the complement of A is basically those elements in reals that are not in A. So it's actually a union of two intervals. All the elements x that are less than equal with minus 1, because minus 1 was not in A, so it must be included in the complement. Union, all the elements that are strictly greater than 0. So the interval from 0 to infinity, not including 0. And similarly, if you want to compute the complement of B, would be the interval from minus infinity to 0, not including 0. Union, the interval from 1 to infinity, including 1. Unions and intersections can also be applied to sequences if the elements of those sequences are sets. So consider that you have a sequence of elements, but these elements are actually sets. So A0, A1, A2 are subsets of some universal set U. And given a non-negative integer, n, basically you have a finite elements in this sequence. For sets, we don't talk about infinite sequences, at least not yet. We can, but they are harder to think about that you have an infinite sequence of sets. In a few minutes, we will. Okay. So we start with a finite sequence of sets, like for instance, A0 to AN. The union of AI for all I from 0 to N, and you can just write it like we wrote the sum notation, union and then I equals 0 to N of A of I, is all the elements in the universe X such that X belongs to A of I for at least one of the indices from 0 to N. The union for I equal 1 to infinity of A of I is basically the all the elements in the universe X such that X belongs to A of I for at least one non-negative integer I. The intersection for I equals 0 to N of all A of I's are all the elements in the universe such that X belongs to A of I for some integer I from 0 to N. And the intersection from 1 to infinity of A of I is the set of all the elements in the universe such that X belongs to A of I for all non-negative integers I. So let's see some examples. So basically, consider that you have the following sequence of sets. A of I is the set of all the real numbers such that X is greater than minus 1 divided by I, and X is less than 1 divided by I. So it's basically the interval from minus 1 divided by I to 1 divided by I. and you can draw it on the real axis. In fact, let me do that. So in Paint, if you have the real axis, and let me actually make it bigger, and let's say that you have the real axis from minus infinity to plus infinity, and somewhere on this real axis we have zero. Let's put it right in the middle. So here it will be zero. Maybe we have other numbers, like we have one here, we have minus one here, minus one on the other side, sorry. So minus one and one, we have one over two, minus one over two and one over two and so on. Let me write them down so it's easy to see. So maybe increase the font a little bit. Okay, so increase the font and write down. So we have one here, then we have a minus one, sorry, minus one, we have minus one divided by two, we have zero, we have one divided by two, we have one, and so on. You can have more values within. You can have here somewhere minus one divided by p, and somewhere here you have one divided by three, and so on. So what would be a of one? So a of one is basically the set of all integer, all real numbers x, such that one divided by one is less than x, which is less, or minus one divided by one, which is strictly less than one divided by one. But one divided by one equals one, and one minus one divided by one is also minus one. So this is basically the set from minus one to one. So if you would represent it, it would basically be the set from, let's draw it this, from here to here, okay? And similarly, if you want a of two would be very similarly defined. A of two is the set of all real numbers x, such that minus one divided by two is less than x, which is less than 1 divided by 2, okay? So this will be basically the set from minus 0.5 to minus 0.5. Okay. So in essence, it will be the smaller set that we can see here is the interval from minus one divided by two to one divided by two. And similarly for three, a of three will be from minus one divided by three to one divided by three. A of four will be from one minus one divided by four to one divided by four, and so on. So basically you get to a smaller and smaller set, okay? So now let's see for this, what would be the union of A of 1 with A of 2 and A of 3? It will be basically all the reals, such that the union of minus 1 to 1, minus 1 divided by 2 to 1 divided by 2, and minus 1 divided by 3 and 1 divided by 3. But you can see that in the image that we draw, that all of these other subsets are within the minus 1 to 1. So the union is basically of A of one with any one of the other elements in the sequence is minus one to one. Similarly, the intersection of A of one with A of two and A of three is the elements that are in common in reals in minus one to one minus 1 divided by 2 to minus 1 divided by 2, and minus 1 divided by 3 and 1 divided by 3, which we can see that these sets are smaller and smaller, and the elements that will be in common are basically those that are in the smallest subset, from minus 1 divided by 3 to 1 divided by 3. So basically that is the intersection. Now, if you have a union from 1 to infinity of A of I, then we can see that although the sets become smaller and smaller, minus 1 to 1 is still the biggest, which contains all of the others. So the union from 1 to infinity of A of I will be from minus 1 to 1. And the intersection from 1 to infinity of A of I is the elements that are in common. But these sets become smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller, from minus 1 divided by I to 1 divided by I. So at the extreme, at the infinity, only 0 is the element that is in common, because these sets become smaller and smaller. For any I index that you choose, you will get a smaller set. To infinity, it will be basically converged towards 0 on both sides, minus 1 divided by I and 1 divided by I. So the intersection will be 0. It's like a convergence for a derivative or an integral. Okay, so let's get to the empty set. So phi is the notation for the empty set, and or you can actually just write the set that doesn't contain anything, is the set that contains no elements. And it can be obtained from operations that we saw before. Like, for instance, if you try to intersect two sets that contain no elements in common, then you basically get the empty set. Or even with the constructive method, the notation for constructing a set, all of the reals such that x is greater than 3 and less than 2 is empty, because there are no elements that are before, that are after 3, but also before 2. Those two on the real axis are completely disjoint subsets or sets, subsets of reals. We say that two such sets, A and B, are disjoint if their intersection is empty, meaning that the sets have no elements in common. So if you are given a sequence of sets, A1 to A2, A3 to AN, they are called mutually disjoint or pairwise disjoint or non-overlapping if no two sets AI and AJ for I different than J have any elements in common. Logically, we write it as for all I and J in the set from 1 to I, 1 to infinity, I is different than J implies the intersection of A of I with A of J is empty. Given a set A, we call a partition of A a collection of non-empty sets A1, A2, A3, and so on, if the union of all the AIs for I from 1 to infinity is equal with A. So basically those AIs cover all the elements in the original set, and AI, A2, A3, and so on are mutually disjoint, meaning that there are no elements that are in common in two of the subsets, AI and AJ. So for instance, if the original set would be like in Venn diagrams, part of the area that contains all of the subsets, a partition is a mutually disjoint set of sets, which basically cover the entire area covered by A. So let me show you an example. If you consider the original set to be a set that contains 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, a partition of that would be A1 that is the set that contains 1 and 2, A2 that contains the set is the set that contains the elements 3 and 4, and A3 that is a set that contains the element 5 and 6. And the reason for that is that the union of A1 with A2 and A3 is the original set A, and A1, A2, and A3 are mutually disjoint. Every one of the pairs A1 with A2, A1 with A3, and A2 with A3, their intersection is empty. Therefore, this is a partition. Those subsets are mutually disjoint, and this is a partition of that set because it contains all of the elements in the original set. Also, if we consider the integer set Z, then T1, being all the integers whose division with 3 gives us a remainder 0, T2 is all the integers whose division by 3 by the quotient remainder theorem could be equal with 1, and T3, which is all the integers such that their division with 3 gives us the remainder 2, is a partition of integers, because we can see that no matter what integer, it can be covered by quotient remainder theorem by one of these subsets, but also these subsets are mutually disjoint. There cannot be any element in common, because if there would be an element in common, then you would reach a contradiction. It must be the case that an integer is equal with a non-integer, a rational number. Power set. The power set of a set is the set of all the subsets of that set. So given A, power set of A is the set of all the subsets of A. So for instance, the power set of the set that contains 1 and 2 is all the set of all the sets that contains 1 and 2. So a subset of the set that contains the elements 1 and 2. So the empty set is a subset of 1 and 2, because all the elements of the empty set are elements in the set that contains 1 and 2. There are no elements in the empty set. It's vacuously true. The set that contains 1 is a subset of the set that contains 1 and 2. The set that contains 2 is a subset of the set that contains 1 and 2. And the set that contains 1 and 2 is a subset of the set that contains 1 and 2. The power set of the empty set, this is harder to understand, is the set that contains the empty set. So remember the definition. It says the power set is the set of all the subsets of that set A. The empty set is a subset of any other set, including the empty set itself. By definition of subset, it basically says, is it true that all the elements in the empty set are elements in any other in another set? Yes, because vacuously true, there is no element in the empty set. Therefore, the empty set is a member of any other set. Specifically, the empty set is a subset of the empty set. Therefore, the power set of the empty set is the set that contains the empty set. Now, the power set of that set, the power set of the set that contains the empty set, is the empty set, the set that contains the empty set, and the set that contains the empty set. Why do we get this? Because this is a set that contains an element. First of all, the empty set is a subset of it, but the set that contains that element is also a subset of it. Therefore, these two are all the subsets of the set that contains the empty set. So basically, we are getting the set that contains the empty set and the set that contains the empty set as basically the set that is the power set of the powers of the set that contains the empty set. And you can continue this. For instance, if somebody is asking you what is the power set of that one, basically this. Okay, now again, you can actually construct is the set that contains the set that contains the empty set, then it will be the set, let me write it first and then we'll see it. Okay, let's make it smaller. Okay, so it will be the set that contains the empty set, the set that contains the empty set, the set that contains the set that contains the empty set, basically the set that contains the second element here, then the set that contains the empty set, and the set that contains the empty set. So basically the original set is a subset of itself. And that's it. So you can see that this is basically what we got, which basically was what was the power set of the power set that can of the empty set. Let me write it down. Okay, it's basically that. And now this one here is basically the power set of the power set of the power set of the empty set. Because you are basically applying this incrementally, it will be the power set of the power set of with the previous element. So it's basically the power set of this. And now it's basically what we just computed. Okay. Okay. So this is another example. Okay. Now, Cartesian product. So first we define an ordered n tuple. So an ordered n tuple is a sequence of arguments x1, x2, xn consisting of the elements x1, x2, xn together with the ordering. First is x1, then it's x2, then so on and up to xn. Two ordered n tuples, x1 to xn and y1 to yn are equal if the number of elements are the same and x1 is equal with y1, x2 is equal with y2 and so on up to xn is equal with yn. So basically the corresponding elements in the two tuples are all equal. The Cartesian product of multiple sets a1 to an is the set of all the n order tuples a1 to an such that a1 belongs to the first set in the Cartesian product uppercase a1, a2 belongs to a2 and an belongs to an. So for instance, if you are given the sets a that is 1 2, b that is 3 4, the Cartesian product of a and b, also called the joint, the join of A and B, A join B, is the set of tuples 1, 3, 1, 4, 2, 3, 2, 4. So for every element in the first set, you group it with every element in the second set. So basically, you have a set of tuples. Okay? So it's basically pairings. You can consider it as an example. You have two sets of people and you want to build groups of the two sets of people, every person in the first set, possibly with every person in the second set. So you basically group them first, the first person with each one of the other people in the second set, then the second person with each one in the second set and so on. So now if you're given multiple sets, A, B, and C. So A is the set of elements X and Y, B is the set of elements 1, 2, 3, and C is the set of elements A and B. Remember that the way that we define Cartesian product was for multiple sets. So A Cartesian product, B Cartesian product, C is the tuples U, V, and W, such that U belongs to A, V belongs to B, and W belongs to C. So it will be X1A as the first tuple, then X1B as the second tuple, and so on. So you basically get a set of unordered elements. You don't need to write them in any specific order. It's easy to write them in the same way that we've wrote truth values in the truth table. Keep the first one the same and the second one the same up to you change the last one, but you don't have to. In fact, that's not the way that I've wrote it here, but you have to cover all of them. You have to cover the number of elements that you will have in the Cartesian product is the number of elements you have in A multiply with the number of elements that you have in B, multiply with the number of elements you have in C. Now, A Cartesian product B Cartesian product C is not equal with A Cartesian product B everything Cartesian product C, because by definition, this Cartesian product C will be the set of tuples UV such that U belongs to the first Cartesian product and V belongs to C. And now you can define the Cartesian product of A and B are those tuples that basically the first argument belongs to A and the second one belongs to B. So if you look the inner values after like you flatten these tuples are the same, but the form is not the same. Basically, you have here you have tuples with three elements or three array tuples, and here you have tuples with two elements, one element that, which is a tuple itself. So be careful when you actually write Cartesian product where you have parentheses, because you don't have associativity kind of like what you have in the case of logic or some logical operators. Okay, so now let's start with the properties of sets. So until now we defined what are the definitions. What does subset mean? What intersection means? What union means? What basically Cartesian product power set means, and so on. But now we can start defining properties like we defined logical equivalences or logical arguments. And later we'll see that we can actually use these properties to prove algebraically other properties, similar to what we did with logical formulas. So the first property. The intersection of a set A with a set B is a subset of the set A, because the elements of the intersection must be elements of both A and B. Therefore, every element that you have in the intersection must be an element of A. So A intersect B is a subset of A. And similarly, A intersect B is a subset of B. The union. A is a subset of A union B. Remember the definition of union. A union B is the set of all the elements that are either in A or in B, including all that are in A. So A is a subset of A union B. Similarly, B is a subset of A union B. Then transitivity of the property of subsets. If A is a subset of B and B is a subset of C, then A is a subset of C. Even if you write them with Venn diagrams, A is an inner circle of B, B is an inner circle of C, therefore A must be an inner circle of C. X is an element of A union B, by definition is logically equivalent or if and only if X is an element of A or X is an element of B. X is an element of A intersect B, if and only if X is an element of A and X is an element of B. X is an element of B minus A, if and only if X is an element of B and X is not an element of A, is the definition that we had for subtraction of sets. X is an element of the complement of A, if and only if X is not an element of A. And the tuple XY is an element of the Cartesian product of A with B, if and only if X is an element of A and Y is not an element of B. So basically, this is all by definitions, except the first ones which can be proven through the element argument proof. And that's what we are going to show next, that basically that these are can be proven, all of them, through the element of element argument proof. Before we get into proving this, let's see if there are any questions. So are there any questions? Let's give everybody opportunity to ask questions.
You can type them in the chat or you can ask them. Okay. So if there are no questions, then we'll continue with the element argument proofs for this subset properties. So the first property that we want to prove is that for all sets A and B, A intersect B is a subset of A. So this statement is a universal statement. It basically says that for all sets A and B, A intersect B is a subset of A. Suppose again by direct method, the method of direct proof, that A and B are any particular but arbitrary chosen sets, such that A intersect B, we must show that is a subset of A. Now, in order to show subset property, by definition, we must show that for every element X, if X belongs to A intersect B, it implies that X belongs to A. Suppose A, again, by the method of direct proof, element argument proof, is any particular but arbitrary chosen element in A intersect B. By definition of A intersect B, X belongs to A and X belongs to B. In particular, X belongs to A, which basically means that every element of A intersect B is also an element of A. Therefore, A intersect B is indeed a subset of A. So we have here actually two applications of the method of direct proof. The first application is that this property is true for all sets A and B. And then the application to show that if you do choose any particular but arbitrary chosen sets A and B, any element of the intersection, arbitrary chosen, is also an element of one of the sets A, for instance. So we use the method of direct proof and then specifically the argument method, argument membership method. Okay. So these are set identities for all sets A, B, and C. Basically, the union of A with B is the union of B with A. Similarly, for intersection, the intersection of A with B is equal with the intersection of B with A, and these are, you can obtain them by using the commutativity laws for disjunction and conjunction. Associativity, basically A union B, A union B union C is equal with A union, the union of B and C. Similarly for intersection, A intersect B intersect C is A intersect the intersection of B with C. Distributivity of union over intersection, we will prove this next. In fact, A union B intersect C is equal with A union B intersect A union C. So A union distributes to B and to C, and then we have an intersection of the two unions. Also in distributivity of intersection over union, so A intersect B union C is A intersect B union A intersect C. So we distribute A intersect over B and C, and we construct the union of those. The identity laws, A union empty set is equal with A, and A intersect the universe is equal with A. The complement laws, A union A complement is equal with the universe, and A intersect A complement is the empty set, because really what they are saying is, what is the intersection between the set A and the set that contains all the elements that are not in A? Those are not, those two sets have no elements in common, so is the empty set. The double complement law, the complement of the complement of A is equal with A, because the complement of A is all the elements that are not in A in the universe, and now the complement of that are those elements that are in A, because they are the elements in the universe that are not in the complement of A.
the idempotent laws, A union A is equal with A and A intersect A is equal with A. The universal bound laws, A union the universe is the universe, and A intersect the empty set is the empty set. The De Morgan laws for set theory, the complement of A union B is the complement of A intersect the complement of B, and the complement of A intersect B is the complement of A union the complement of B. The absorption laws, A union A intersect B is equal with A, and A intersect A union B is equal with A. The complement of the universe is the empty set, and the complement of the empty set is the universe. And the fact that a set difference can be written as an intersection of with a complement. So A minus B is the intersection of A with the complement of B. So let's prove most of these logical identity, set identities, and then we'll basically see that they actually stand for the equivalent Boolean identities in propositional logic. So, first property that we will prove is distributivity of union over intersection. For all sets A, B, and C, A union B intersect C is A union B intersect A union C. So, method of direct proof. Suppose that A, B, and C are arbitrarily chosen sets. The equality has to be proven by proving that the first set is a subset of the second set and the second set is a subset of the first set. So, we'll basically prove it. A union B intersect C is a subset of A union B intersect A union C. So by method, the argument method, we have to show that for all X, if X belongs to the first set, then it belongs to the second set too. Suppose that X belongs to A union B intersect C, arbitrarily chosen. We must now show that it also belongs to the intersection of the unions. So let's take the first definition, that X belongs to A union B intersect C. By definition, it means that A belongs to A or X belongs to the intersection of B and C. Case one, if X belongs to A, then by definition of the union, X belongs to A union B and X belongs to A union C. Therefore, by definition of intersection, A belongs to the intersection of A union B and A union C. The second case, if X belongs to the intersection of B and C, by definition of intersection, it means that X belongs to B and X belongs to C. By definition of union, if X belongs to B, it also belongs to A union B, some other set union B. Also by definition of union, if X belongs to C, it belongs to C union A. And now by definition of intersection, it means that X belongs to A union B intersect with A union C. So every element in A union B intersect C is also an element of A union B intersect A union C. The opposite can be proven in a similar manner. And actually, I'm going to show it to you just because I want to show you how to write such proofs in Notepad. Like, if you do not have an editor, then you will have to write it manually, no? So, suppose, and this is how you will write it in the exam, that X is in, and now we can basically write it A union, sorry, B, everything intersect A union C. Okay. By definition, so this is particular, not arbitrarily chosen. type. Okay, good. Now, by definition of intersection, it basically means that X belongs, X is in both these two unions. So X is in that and X is in this. Okay. So now, from the first one, it basically, there are two possible cases. So if X belongs to that, then there are two possible cases. Then either X is in A or X is in B. Case one is that X is in A. So now we have the second statement, which is directly true because it is in A union C. Okay, so this is true. We don't need it because we can see that is in A. Okay, we have to show this part, that A, that X is in the union of A with B intersects C. But since A, X is in A, then X is also in A union anything else, in particular the intersection of B with C. So case one is proven. Case two, X is not in A, but we have that X is in the union of A with B and X is in the union of A with C. So if X is not in A, but it is in the union, it implies that must be the case that X is in B. So the only the definition by union it must be either in A or in B. But is not in A, therefore it must be in B. Similarly, from the fact that X is in A union C, but it is not in A, it implies that X is in C. Again, by definition of union, since it's not in A, it must be in C. Therefore, X is in B intersect C. By definition of intersection, is in both. So if it is in A intersect C, it's also in A union B intersect C, which shows basically that in either case, we have basically what we need to prove, that we basically prove that every element in the first set is also an element in the second set. So done. QED. Era demonstratum. Basically, end of the proof. Okay. That's it. So that's how you prove set identity for basically equality. You have to prove both directions. You prove that one is a subset of the other and vice versa. Next one, the De Morgan laws for sets. Basically, the fact that A union B complement is A complement intersect B complement. Again, we want to prove it for all sets A and B. So suppose by method of direct proof that A and B are arbitrary, particularly arbitrarily chosen sets. Suppose that, again, we want to prove that any element in the first subset is a it's also in the second subset. So suppose that X is a member of A union B complement. By definition of complement, X is not an element of A union B. So it is false that X is in A or X is in B. By the Morgan law of logic, negation of disjunction is conjunction of the negations. So X is not in A and X is not in B, which can be written as basically X is not an element of A and X is not an element in B. X is not an element in A means that X is an element in the complement of A. Similarly, if X is not in B, then X is an element in the complement of B, because by definition of complement are those elements in the universe that are not in the original set. If X is in the complement and is in the complement of A and is in the complement of B, then it is in the intersection of the complements. So basically, we show that every element in the first set here is an element in the second set. Similarly, we have to prove the opposite. Every element in here, so let's write that proof down in text mode. So every element in the intersection of the two complements is a subset of the complement of the union of the two sets. Okay? So how do we prove this? Again, basically let X be a particular but arbitrarily chosen. Element in A complement union intersection B complement. Okay. By definition of intersection, we basically have that X is in A complement and X is in B complement. Now, what does the definition of complement? It means that X is not in A and X is not in B. Okay? So if X is not in A and X is not in B, now we use the Morgan in logic, and this is logical equivalent with not of X in A or X in B. Okay, so not, so it means that not of this is basically X is in A or X is in B. Let's take that one, the inner formula is not of X in A union B. But this is the complement. So this is equal with basically with X is in the complement of A union B. Okay, or basically what it's A union B is in the A union B complement. I put the C at the end, meaning that. So every element that was in the first set is basically also an element of the complement of the union. So this is the end of the proof. And we wrote it in text. Unfortunately, we have to do this for the exam. There is no other way that we can take the exam in the lockdown browser. Okay, the next property that we will prove is that if A is a subset of B, then A intersect B is equal with A, and A union B is equal with B. This is a property true for all sets A and B with that antecedent, and we have this consequent of that implication. So again, basically, how do we prove equality? We prove based on this property that A intersect B is a subset of A, and A is a subset of A intersect B. So that's how we prove equality. So the first part, we basically want to prove that A intersect B is a subset of A. But this is true by the definition of the inclusion intersection property, which we just proved, in fact. Suppose now for the second part that we want to prove A is a subset of A intersect B, that X belongs to A, arbitrarily chosen. By the property that A is a subset of B, we get that X also belongs to B by the definition of subset. Now, if X belongs to A and belongs to B, it belongs to the intersection. So every element that belongs to A also belongs to the intersection of A intersect B. Therefore, A is a subset of B. For the second equality, A union B is equal with B, we have again two formulas to prove that A union B is a subset of B, and B is a subset of A union B. The second part is simple because every element of B is also an element of the union. For the first part is in a similar manner. Assume that X is an element of the union. Therefore, X must be an element of A or an element of B. If it's an element of A, because A is a subset of B, is also an element of B. So X is an element of B, no matter if it's an element of A or B. So basically, it's an element of B. The empty set properties. First of all, we define that a set with no elements the empty set is a subset of every set. So it's a proof by vacuously true statement. If E is the set of no elements and A is any set, E is the subset of A. It's a proof by contradiction. Suppose that there exists an empty set E with no elements and A, and suppose that E is not a subset of A. By the definition of not a subset, there is an element E in E, X, such that is not an element of A. But we just got a contradiction because we assume that E is the empty set. So it cannot be the case that X belongs to E. So basically, we prove by contradiction that the empty set is a subset of any other set. Second proof is that the empty set is unique. There is only one set with no elements. Again, proof by contradiction, suppose that E1 and E2 are two sets with no elements. By the Brough property, E1 is a subset of E2, and E2 is a subset of E1. But now we basically get that E1 is equal with E2, so there is only one empty set. You can prove it actually by just choosing two arbitrary elements, kind of like the method of direct proof, but you can also prove it by contradiction. Now, how do we prove that a set is empty? We prove it by contradiction, and this kind of proof is called the element method proof. Suppose that X has an element and derive a contradiction that it could have been an element of that set, therefore the original set must have been empty. Okay. So let's prove the following property of the empty set, that the intersection of any set A with the empty set is the empty set. So let A be a particular but arbitrarily chosen set. And we want to prove that A intersect the empty set is the empty set. Basically, that A intersect empty set has no elements. By contradiction, we can suppose that there is some X such that X belongs to A intersect empty set. By definition of the intersection, we get that X belongs to A and that X belongs to the empty set. But now we got the contradiction because empty set has no elements. So X cannot belong to the empty set. Let's get a harder property. For all sets A, B, and C, if A, A is a subset of B and B is a subset of the complement of C, then A intersects C is equal with empty set. So again, method of direct proof, suppose A and B, A, B, and C are any sets such that A is subset of B and B is a subset of the complement of C. By the element method, suppose that this set A intersects C is not empty, that there exists an element X member of A intersects C. By definition of intersection, it means that X is an element of A and X is an element of C. From A is an element, X is an element of A, and A is a subset of B, we get that X must be an element of B. From X is an element in B, and B is a subset of the complement of C, we get that X is an element in the complement of C. So by definition of complement, we get that X is not an element in C, but the original assumption that X is an element in intersection also had that X is an element in C. So we basically get a contradiction that we cannot have that both X is an element in C and is not an element in C. Therefore, this set must be empty. There cannot be elements in that set. So this is how you prove that a set is empty. You assume that there is an element in the intersection, and then by the antecedent of that implication, prove that it cannot be the case, because you get that is an element in the set and is not an element in the set at the same time. We will do more such proofs using the element argument proof in the recitation today. Disproofs. We want to disprove a property by finding a counterexample for which that property is false. So for instance, the property that for all sets A, B, and C, A minus B union B minus C is equal with A minus C. So the first thing that I usually recommend that one does is to draw on a piece of paper like scrap sheet the Venn diagrams of these cases and consider the more general case, the case in which there are elements in A that are not in B and C, but there are some elements in A that are in B, but not in C. There are elements in A that are in C, but not in B. And there are elements in A that are in A, in B, and in C in common, and so on. So the more general case. And see what are the elements in that set. So the elements that are in A but not in B are basically the ones that are here in A but not in B. Then union with elements that are in B but not in C. So basically union with these elements here will be basically all of these elements that are in A, in B, not in C but in B, but they can be in A. And then draw the Venn diagram for those elements that are in A minus C. So basically they are in A but not in C. And then see if those two are equal. We don't want to lose power like we did last time. Good. So now to show that the property is false, find such sets. And then you show that there is an element, like for instance, that is here in B. In the left hand side set, but not in the right hand side set. So here is an example. Consider that the set A is 1, 2, 4, and 5. The set B is 2, 3, 5, and 6. The set C is 4, 5, 6, and 7. And then you will see that A minus B union B minus C is the set 1, 2, 3, 4.
but A minus C is the set 1, 2. You can find a simpler counter example. A is the empty set, B is the set that contains 1, and C is the empty set. Then the left-hand side here is the empty set. The left-hand side here is the set that contains 1, and the right-hand side here is the empty set. Let me actually write it down, okay? So, oops. So what is actually the left-hand side and the right-hand side in the second example? So in the second example, the left-hand side will just be empty set union, the set that contains 1, which is just the set that contains 1. And the right-hand side is the empty set, because A is the empty set, okay? So really, you can easily show an example that shows this specific case, okay? Next, cardinality of sets. So the cardinality of the set A, denoted by N of A, or we use vertical bar A, vertical bar, is a measure of how many elements are in that set, distinct elements in that set. So the cardinality of the set 2, 4, and 6 is equal with 3. Basically, there are 3 elements in that set. For any set A and B, the following property is true. The cardinality of the union of A and B plus the cardinality of the intersection of A and B is equal with the cardinality of A plus the cardinality of B. In the case that A and B are disjoint, basically in Venn diagrams you have A and we have B completely disjoint, then the cardinality of the union of A and B is the cardinality of A plus the cardinality of B. And in fact, the cardinality of the intersection is equal with 0. Because if they are disjoint, then they have no elements in common. Okay? So basically, these properties are true about cardinality. Now, another property of cardinality is the number of elements in the power set. So consider that we have a set X with n elements. If n is greater than or equal with 0 as the number of elements, the power set of X will have 2 to the power n elements. And we can prove it by mathematical induction. Okay. So consider that the property Q of n that we want to prove is that any set with n elements has 2 to the power n subsets. We have to prove it in the base case first, and then we have to prove the inductive step. So in the base case is that the cardinality of the power set of the empty set has 1 element. So basically it says that any set with 0 elements has 2 to the power 0 subsets. The power set of the empty set, if you remember, was the set that contains the empty set, which is a set that contains 1 element. So the number of subsets of the empty set is 2 to the power 1, 2 to the power 0, which is equal with 1, which is that one single element. Now, assume the property is true for some integer k. Basically, the number of subsets of a set of k elements is 2 to the power k. And therefore, and then prove that the number of subsets of a set of k plus 1 elements is 2 to the power k plus 1. So the premise, the antecedent of the inductive step is that any set with k elements has 2 to the power k subsets. We want to show that for a set with k plus 1 elements, it has 2 to the power k plus 1 subsets. So let X be the set of k plus 1 elements, and Z, one element arbitrarily chosen from X. Okay? Now, it must be the case that X has at least 1 element, because we started with k being greater than or equal with 0, therefore k plus 1 must be greater than or equal with 1. Now, X minus the set that contains Z has K elements. By definition, by the inductive step, we have a hypothesis. We have that the power set of the set X minus the set that contains Z has 2 to the power K elements. Now, any subset of A of that set difference, X minus the set that contains Z, is also a subset of the original set X, okay? Because if it's a subset of the set minus Z, it must be a subset of X itself. So that A belongs to the power set of X. Any subset can also be matched with Z. So A union the set that contains Z is also in the power set, is also a possible subset. Okay. So all the possible subsets of X are those that were in X minus the set that contains Z, and those that were in X minus the set that contains Z union Z. So basically, we add Z to every one of the previous subsets. All of the subsets of A and A union Z are all the subsets of X, because there are no other possible subsets that you can create. You have those that were originally in X minus the set that contains Z, and those that you added Z to those subsets. So in the first case, we have 2 to the power K elements, and then we have 2 to the power K distinct elements, which is basically 2 to the power K, which is 2 to the power k plus 1 elements, okay? So really, we have 2 to the power k, 2 plus 2 to the power k. Let me write it down. Plus 2 to the power k, which is twice 2 to the power k, which is 2 to the power k plus 1 elements. So we enumerated the set identities before, and like we had symbolic proofs in logic, we can have symbolic proofs called algebraic proofs in set identities. So consider that all of these properties are true. They can be proven by the method of direct proof, element argument method. Now you can prove new set identities. Like for instance, for all sets A, B, and C, A union B minus C is equal with A minus C union B minus C. So the algebraic proof will take us from the left-hand side to the right-hand side. So first of all, A union B minus C. By the set difference law, is A union B intersect C complement. Basically, this was the last rule that we had here, that A minus B is A intersect B complement. And we proved it before. Now, by commutativity of intersection, this is equivalent with C complement intersect A union B. By distributivity of intersection over union, this is equal with C complement intersect A union C complement intersect B. Again, by commutativity of intersection, this will be equal with A intersect C complement union B intersect C complement. We applied that commutativity of intersection twice. And now by definition of difference law, the set difference law, we get A minus C union B minus C. So we brought that this set is equal with this set. Now, it's also true that you can prove it with the element argument proof and both directions for subset. But we don't have to, because we basically only used set identities that were known to us in the previous steps. So it's a much shorter proof than the one we did for subsets element argument proofs. Next property. A minus A intersect B is equal with A minus B. So again, we start with the left-hand side of this formula, A minus A intersect B, by the set difference law, is A intersect A intersect B complement. By De Morgan law, the complement of an intersection is the union of the complements. So this is equal with A intersect A complement union B complement. By distributivity of intersection of a union, we get A intersect A complement union A intersect B complement. The intersection of a set with its complement is the empty set. That's the complement law. Then we have the union of the empty set with A intersect B complement by commutativity law is A intersect B complement union the empty set. By identity law, set union the empty set is equal with that set. And then by set difference law, A intersect B complement is A minus B. And we basically got from the left-hand side to the right-hand side. You have to exercise a lot of these so that you basically can show such set identities and to see how to apply these laws. Now, one thing that you may have noticed up to now is that actually the set identities are identical with the logical equivalences if you consider union to be disjunction and intersection to be conjunction. For every one of the logical equivalences that we had in logic, the set properties are also set identities. So you can see that conjunction is associative, so is disjunction. Union is associative, so is intersection. Also that conjunction distributes over disjunction, intersection distributes over union. Similarly for distribution of disjunction over conjunction. Then we have the disjunction, the identity logical equivalences P or contradiction is P. Similarly for set properties, A union, the empty set is A. And same for intersection and so on. So basically we have the same properties in both words, which basically means that there is one common algebraic mathematical algebra for both logics, for both mathematical theories. Basically, it's called Boolean algebra. And the point again is that disjunction corresponds to union, conjunction corresponds to intersection, negation corresponds to complement, tautologies correspond to the universe U, contradictions correspond to the empty set, and therefore both sets and logic are theories of the same general structure Boolean algebra. Now, in Boolean algebra, we use two other notations for the operators. Plus is used for the union and disjunction, and dot is used for the conjunction and intersection. And the commutative laws, associative laws, distributive laws, they all basically hold exactly as we had them in the logic and set theory. You can basically read plus as plus and dot as multiplication, but don't remember it as multiplication because basically it doesn't stand for multiplication. Like for instance, in this case, A plus B multiplied with C is not A plus B multiplied with A plus C in algebra, in arithmetics. So that's why you have to remember them as Boolean algebra plus and dot, not as multiplication. Otherwise, you will make some mistakes. Okay. But some properties stand. So for instance, A plus Z is A, A dot 1 is A. So these kind of stand for multiplication and summation. Okay, good. And complement, remember it, we use A bar as the complement or the negation of A. So A plus the complement of A is equal with 1. So the union between a set and its complement is the universe, and the product of a set and its complement is the empty set or the intersection. So the easiest way to think about this is either that you think about it in logic or that you think about it in set theory, and you read the dot as intersection and the plus as union. Otherwise, you are prone to make mistakes if you think about them as mathematical operators, plus and multiplication. The same properties that hold in set theory hold in Boolean algebra. So for any sets A, all A and X in B, A, if A plus 1 is equal with 1, A plus X is equal with 1, and A times X is equal with 0, then X must be the complement of A. Also, the uniqueness of 0 and 1, if there exists an X in B such that A plus X is equal with A for all A and B, then X must be the empty set. So the if the union between A and X is A, then X must be empty set. And if there exists a Y in B such that A intersect Y is A for all A in B, then Y must be the universe. The double complement law is that the complement of the complement of A, is the same with set theory. The idempotent law, A plus A is equal with A, so A union itself is the same set, and A times A or A intersect A is equal with itself. The universal bound law is that A union the universe is the universe, and A intersect the empty set is the empty set. The De Morgan laws, the complement of A union B is the intersection of the complement of A and the complement of B, and the complement of A intersect B is the union of the complement of A and the complement of B, which we proved for the set theory. The absorption laws is that for all A and B in S in B, in Boolean algebra, the union of A and B intersect A is equal with A, and the union between A intersect B and A is equal with A, and the complement of the empty set is the universe, and the complement of the universe is the empty set. So think about them, although they are plus and dot, as union and intersection. So let's, for instance, prove one of them. So for instance, I want to prove using these algebraic proofs that for any A and X in Boolean algebra, if A union X is the universe and A intersect X is the empty set, then X must be the complement of A. Again, by method of direct proof, suppose A and X are particular but arbitrarily chosen in Boolean algebra that satisfy that hypothesis. And the hypothesis was that A union X is the universe and A intersect X is the empty set. Now, by identity law, X, so we start with X. X is X intersect the universe. Because by identity law, if you intersect any set with the universe, you get the same set. Now, the universe can be written as the union of A and its complement. Now, you can distribute intersection over union. So we get X intersect A, union X intersect the complement of A. You can, by commutativity, you can swap X in, and A in the first operand. So we get A intersect X union X intersect A complement. But A intersect X is empty set. So basically it's 0 plus X intersect A complement. But 0 can be written as A intersect its complement. And by commutativity, we can swap them. We can get the complement of A intersect A union the complement of A intersect X. You can give the complement of A by distributivity law intersect with the union of A and X. We know that the union of A and X, by the assumption that the premise was correct, was true, is one, it's the universe. And then the complement of A intersect the universe is the complement of A, is the identity law for one. So if you think about all of these properties as being the properties in set theory, then you basically are just using the set theory, set identities to prove these properties. And again, if such a problem comes in the exam, I will give you the list of all the set, all the logical equivalences, all the set identity properties, or the laws that are true for Boolean algebra. But you can think about them like set theories, so it's easier to understand them. Okay. One more thing that I want to cover at the end, but this is not required in the exam, is the fact that at the beginning of the last century, in about 1900, people thought that they can prove every one of the logical equivalences, like for instance these ones for or set identities, using this kind of algebraic proofs. And people were actually developing sets of inference rules to try to prove every property in first order logic or in set theory. However, Bertram Russell came with an example, which is a paradox. And basically it showed for the first time that not quite every formula can be proven to be true or false. And there are solutions, some solutions to this. You can define sets, for instance, as sets that can be constructed from other known sets, and then you don't have such paradoxes. But it has a result that is very important for computer science, which is the undecidability theorem, that not every program terminates. Okay, and I will show you towards the end of this lecture that property. But let's start with Russell's paradox. So most sets are not defined to be elements of themselves. However, imagine that a set A is an element and itself too. So syntactically, we can build this, because we said that elements of a set can also be sets themselves. But therefore, you can actually have a set, a formula defined as follows. A is a member of A. Okay. Let S be constructively defined as the set of all the set of all the elements which are not elements of themselves. So S is the set of all A's, such that A is a set and A is not an element of A. Now, the question that one wants to ask, so syntactically, this is a correct definition. It's basically S is the set of all A's where A is not a member of A. And this is syntactically, everything is fine. Now you can ask a question, is S a member of S? And there is no answer to this question, because if you assume that S is a member of S, then by definition, it cannot be a member. It cannot be a member of S, because S was the set of only those sets which are not members of themselves. So S is not a member of itself, will lead to a contradiction. However, if you assume that S is not a member of itself, then by definition of S, S is the set of all sets that are not members of themselves. So it follows that S is a member of itself. So although this set is syntactically defined to be a correct set, we cannot respond to a simple question, is S a member of itself? Okay. So now it's actually the first example that sometimes you may be given properties which you cannot prove, and not because the set of axioms is not complete, but because there are no axioms that can allow, that can help you to prove these properties. Okay. The original puzzle was actually defined in more intuitive manner. We have the following sentence: in a town, there is a male barber who shaves all those men and only those men who do not shave themselves. And the question is, does the barber shave himself? Or who's shaving the barber? We know that there is a barber that is defined as follows, that shaves all those men and only those men who do not shave themselves. So the question is, first question is, does the barber shave himself? And now there are two possibilities in a two-valued logic. The barber shaves himself, then by definition is a member of the class of men that shaves themselves. The barber does not shave himself because he doesn't shave men who shaves themselves. And now we reach a contradiction that if the barber shaves himself, then he doesn't shave himself. Similarly, if the barber doesn't shave himself, then he's a member of the class of men who do not shave themselves. By definition of barber, the barber shaves every man in the class of men that do not shave themselves. So it must be the case that the barber shaves himself, and yes, we derive a contradiction again. So both yes and no derive contradictions, which means that there is no answer. You cannot respond neither yes nor no to this statement. Okay. So one possible solution is that except power sets, whenever you define a set, you must define it as a constructive definition as a subset of a known set that was defined before. Then the Russell paradox does not allow you to define this set S. So this set S doesn't exist, therefore there is no paradox. But this is quite a basically definition that is too restrictive, because the general case is actually the case that we saw with the Russell's paradox. So given an algorithm, and this is just for you to know, so none of this from Russell's paradox onwards is required in the midterm. It's too complicated and I will not require it to the midterm. But it has a very important consequence to computer science. And that consequence is the following property. There is no computer algorithm that accepts any algorithm X and the data set S, a D as an input, and will output halt or holds or loops forever to indicate whether or not X will terminate in a finite number of steps run on the set D. So basically what this says is that there is no algorithm that can take a program and an input, any program and any input to that program, and in a finite number of steps tell you if that algorithm finishes or not. And I give here a sketch of the proof, which actually is a proof that you will go through towards the end of the Theory of Computation course, CSC 303 at Stony Brook, which basically it's a proof by contradiction. Suppose that you have such an algorithm, check halt, that for any input algorithm X and any data set D, it prints halt or halts or loops forever. Then a new test algorithm, test of X, loops forever if check of halt given X and X, X as the algorithm and X as the data, prints halt, or stops if it loops forever. What is the result of test of test? So if test of test terminates after a finite number of steps, then it must have been the case that it held, looped forever. So check how halt of test and test is halt, and test of test loops forever. But that's a contradiction because we assume to be that it terminates in a finite number of steps. If test of test does not terminate after a finite number of steps, then check halt of test test prints loops forever. So test of test terminates. but we assume that it doesn't terminate after number of finite number of steps. So again, we reach a contradiction. So the algorithm check hold doesn't exist. So there is no algorithm that, given any algorithm and the data set, tells you if it terminates or not. Again, it's not required for the midterm, but it's a good intuitive way to think about this when you take theory of computation in a couple of semesters. And that's the end of the set theory that we'll cover today. So really, what we covered up to Boolean algebra were standard properties of set theory. And definitions of set theory. Yes, so there are a couple of questions in the chat. First, the last one that I see is, can you use U to represent union? Yes, you can use capital U. It's probably easier to use than type it out as union. Also, maybe more intuitive for some of you. The only problem is that for intersection, you can't type the inverse U during the exam, okay? So that I will just would use intersect. Yes, you will be given the set of set identities exactly the same way that you will be given the set of Boolean algebra identities. What's the Cartesian product of the empty set with the empty set? So that is the empty set, because the set of tuples that basically do contain the second element in the empty set is empty. And that's the responses to all of the questions. Okay, great. Okay, so I will stop the recording and we'll get into